You've made an incredible comic book, and now you don't want some soulless corporation coming along, stealing your idea, ripping the guts out of it, leaving you broke and penniless and living in a box in the alley. Maybe I'm being a little bit dramatic, but let me show you how to copyright and trademark your comic book to help keep that from happening to you. So I'm going to show you how to copyright and trademark your comic books, but I'm also going to probably give you a little bit more into just how copyright law works and the understanding why things are the way they are and kind of give you some meaning to this. So this is a subject that I'm really well versed in. I've actually taught this every year to my high school students as a film teacher about how copyright works. So this is something that I actually have quite a bit of a knowledge about. The first thing about copyrights is people will often say, I want to copyright my idea. But you can't copyright an idea. You can copyright your intellectual property. Your intellectual property is your idea expressed in a tangible form. So you can't just say, I have an idea about a character who can fly and I want to copyright that, because that's not a tangible form. I mean, how many times have we seen a character who can fly? So you have to actually express your idea fully, and then you can copyright that as intellectual property. Other thing about copyrights a lot of people don't know is once you create your intellectual property, it is already copyrighted within the universe. So it's like, no matter where you are, if I created it in the furthest region of the island in Hawaii and a cave and no one knows I'm there and I created it, it's already copyrighted because I created it and it's created in the universe. But the reason why we file a copyright with the government is so that we're putting it on record. So if someone else comes along and say, hey, I did this, you say, well, I did it first on this date. And that's why we file a copyright with copyright.gov. Because if you have to go to court to fight over your copyright, you have to go to court with paper. So if you go to court and say, well, I created it on this date, but I didn't tell nobody because I was in a cave in Hawaii and I told my girlfriend a couple years later, and then maybe she had showed it to somebody and I don't know how it got here, but that's definitely my work. And you have nothing else to say except for I created it in a cave in Hawaii. It's not going to hold up in court, because understand this about copyright. And copyright law is a very big entity in the United States. Court is about proof, and proof is paperwork. So you got to have paperwork in your hand in court, and that's why it's important to file a copyright. And when someone takes your work, takes your copywritten work, it's called a copyright infringement. Now the basic copyright law is 95 years to make money off your creation and off your work. And after 95 years, it expires and your work then falls into the public domain where anyone can use it. So copywriting is pretty easy on a copyright.gov website. It's all pretty much self-explanatory. You log in or you sign up. You go through step by step through the process. It'll cost you about $65. So it's pretty simple. It's not a hard thing to do and so on. But they actually have a video on the website there as well to show you exactly how it's done. That was deep. I think that's probably worth a like. I think it is. I mean, you may not think so, but I think it's worth a like. And you can subscribe too. That's also an option if you want to. You can like and subscribe. You can do both. You can do both. But I definitely liked the video so the algorithm could share it, because that was deep. Copyright your story. You copyright, again, a movie, a book, a song, a poem, creative works. But your trademark is what you use to protect your logo, the title of your book, your characters. And you can trademark sayings like
your friendly neighborhood Spider-Man.
And to trademark, you trademark under the United States Patent and Trade Office, USPTO, and it's USPTO.org. And trademarking is harder to do than doing a copyright, but it's actually a good idea that it's harder to trademark a character than it is. And here's why. So let's go back to the scenario that I said before. I have an idea about a character who's strong and who can fly. So again, we've already known that there's, you know, a dozen characters that you can, that's right off the top of your head, you can think about who's strong and who can fly. You don't want someone coming around, especially like a big corporation, is saying, okay, I'm trademarking every character who's strong. I'm trademarking somebody who can fly. I'm trademarking superheroes. I'm trademarking any superhero that can swim, you know, just on and on and on. So if that was the case, then somebody like Marvel or somebody, you know, not saying Marvel would do this, but they can just trademark everything and any kind of remote capacity, and then you go and create your character, and they say, aha, we trademarked it before you, we got you, so you owe us money now because we own that and you don't. When you're trademarking your character, you have to make a very well-versed expression of who the character is. So it's not just about a guy who can fly. It's about a guy who can fly, who came from another planet. He has super strength, affected by the sun. He wears a big S on his chest. So it has to be a defined idea of who that character is. It can't just be a guy who can fly. The thing about it that sucks is it's a lot more expensive. A trademark costs somewhere in the neighborhood of $500 to $600 to do. And it's very difficult to do. So I went to figure out I was going to trademark, because copywriting was very easy. I was going to go and trademark my work. And when I went to trademark my comic book title, you know, characters, things like that, I went to look at it and it felt like I walked into the Matrix. And it's so involved, I strongly suggest, now you do what you want, but I strongly suggest that you get a trademark attorney to help you trademark. I did not do it myself. I looked at it, I thought about attempting it, and then when I realized, you know, how involved it is, and if you make a mistake, you do not get your money back. You make a mistake to say, this is wrong, you filed the wrong way, it's not the right expression of it, you're only supposed to send one of these instead of two, and you sent two, so now we're not going to accept it, and that money is just gone. They say, well, try again, and then you say you go and try again, and you spend another $500-$600 and do it again, and you still can get it wrong. So it's better to hire a trademark attorney. So a trademark attorney is going to run you about another $500-$600. Now, I paid I trademarked MUNCH. I paid $1,535 because I really expanded my trademark for the title of MUNCH. You can't trademark your title until you have a series in effect. So you can't trademark, I could not trademark MUNCH as a single comic book. But because MUNCH exists in three issues, I have three issues and I have the graphic novel, because it exists in that fashion, then I was able to trademark it because it showed a series of books. So you can't trademark trademark your title on one book. You have to trademark it as a series. You can trademark the logo. So it could be MUNCH and I can have MUNCH as a logo, and I can trademark that as a logo, which is another charge. Again, not the same thing. With only on one book, but you can't trademark the title as a book unless you have a series of books on that. So if you're starting a book and you want to trademark it, you can't trademark the title until you get at least two books in a series to do that. There are people out there who do trademarking work who are not attorneys, and you can become a trademark person. You don't have to be an attorney to be a trademark person or to be one of a trademark person to work with people. And again, because I looked at what would it take for me to understand trademarking so I can do trademarking myself, and I could save myself a bunch of money without having to hire a lawyer to do all this trademarking stuff that I want to do. And when I looked at it, I said, for me to really figure this out and get good at it, you know, I never mind doing the hard work. I never mind, you know, taking that climb. But it was like probably 8 months to a year, probably, I'm figuring, to get good at it. It's almost like taking a college course and learning how to do trademarking. And I was like, I don't want to do this. This is really going to take me out of my space of where I want to go. And I've realized at the end of the day, because not just the money, but the lack of the headache and not worrying about getting it wrong or having to go back and fight and appeal with the United States Patent and Trade Office. Because here's the thing. It's not a fast turnaround. Once you put your trademark stuff in, when I put my trademark stuff in, we finally filed it. It took almost a good 4 to 5 months before they got back and said it's approved or it's pending to be approved. So if you do it and you do it wrong, and they come back 5 months in and say you did it wrong and we took your money, now you got to do it again. And you got to wait another 5 months. So it's not a fast turnaround. So you know you're going to be in that kind of that loop. So, long story short, I recommend, you don't have to take my word for it, you can do whatever you want, it's worth getting the trademark attorney to trademark your title, your logo, your books, your characters, so forth and so on. So because it is so expensive, I think a lot of folks that we're going to look at it and say, well, I just can't afford to trademark it, so I'm not going to put my book out because I can't afford to trademark it yet. And I would say this, Don't do that. If you're ready to put your book out, go ahead and put it out. I'm going to say not to worry. I would say be concerned, but don't worry. Because the likelihood of someone coming along, especially any random person coming along and saying, wow, I like this, I'm going to steal it, and I'm going to take it, I'm going to trademark it and copyright it and take everything away from this person, is not really likely. It can happen, yes, but it's not really likely. Can you get into a car accident? Yes. How likely is it getting in a car accident? It's a lot more likely getting into a car accident than someone coming along and stealing your comic book or your idea. Put it out there. You know, build a fan base, let people see what you're doing, keep working on what you're doing. Don't let it go forever. You know, like, you want to build it up. If you start making money, you know, start putting money aside. Or if you're doing like a Kickstarter, put some of that Kickstarting money aside for taking care of like the trademark and things like that as you go along and grow in what you're doing. That's just how I would advise people who ask me, but I am not an attorney, so don't say I put it out because Shannon Newby said I can put my work out and no one's going to steal it and someone stole it, so I'm going to come at the Shannon Newby because he said it was okay. I did not say that. What I'm saying is be concerned about it, but I personally would not let that stop me from creating and sharing my work, and especially in these early stages of doing it. And when you trademark your character, you trademark it with one picture only. If you take and send a bunch of pictures to trademark your character because you just want to make sure that your character is very well defined in a picture. Like it's like if you do a 360 of the character, they want to charge you separately for each one of those things. So you're just going to need one picture. But here's the thing. Again, if you get yourself a good trademark attorney, they will explain those things to you. They will know how this works and they will explain to you so you won't run into that issue. Poor man copyright, poor man trademark. So, poor man copyright is people would create something, like a comic book or a book, and they will put it in the mail, and they will mail it to themselves, and they'll have it stamped on the back with a little postmark on the back, and then it will mail it to themselves, and they'll keep it sealed. And so if someone stole their idea, they can go to court and say, I copyrighted this, or I made this on January 2nd, 2024, and I mailed it to myself, and here's the stamp, and the post office stamped it and put the little mark on it. And you can see that it has not been opened, and now I'm bringing it to court, and here's my proof, Your Honor, and they will not honor that. So years ago, that actually used to be a thing, and people used to actually win cases by showing their poor man copyright, but that no longer exists, and they no longer will accept it in court as proof. Secondly, poor man trademark. This actually does still work to some extent. It does. So I'm saying, and it's not really called a poor man's trademark. If you create something like a title of a book or a logo, and you want to trademark it, but you don't have the money to trademark it yet, you can do the little TM in a circle that says trademark. It can give you a tool to help fight it in court. So again, the TM says, I'm saying it's mine on this date. I don't know if somebody else may already have it, but I'm putting a little TM to it next to it because it's mine. And if someone else has it, I don't know, but it's mine. So I actually used that because I did not trade for my logo for my TV show, Heavy Sedation. So my TV show, Heavy Sedation, was a national public television show. You know, I didn't have money to trademark every little thing. So I used my TM text to my logo, which was the thought bubble with the words Heavy Sedation in it with the font and the little TM next to it. And I was just saying that this is mine. So I kind of put it on T-shirts and bags and all kinds of stuff. So someone came along and say, hey, I had this before you, Heavy Sedation, and a trademark in the thought bubble. And here's my legitimate paperwork. And then I would be forced to cease and desist at that point if that happened. And then you see the R with the circle, which is registered trademark. You put the R because you actually did register it with the Copyright Office, the United States Patent Trade Office.org, USPTO. And that circle, and the R in a circle is for that. So now you've copyrighted your story and you trademark your character and you trademark your logo and you trademark your title. No one can ever come and steal it from you ever, right? So here's the exclusive stuff. This is why you came to this video. This is the stuff you're not going to get anywhere else. Just because you copywritten your work and you trademarked it and you could be totally on the right side of the law, you have everything done perfectly, someone still can come along and steal it from you. For creative works, it's the copyrights. Trademark, then there's patents. And patents are for protecting physical products. So let's say you create a new kind of door hinge and you want to have that protected, then you have to file a patent at the U.S. Patent and Trade Office. There was a guy who created the intermittent wiper that you have on your car. So instead of your wiper just going back and forth, it goes back, you know, that. When your wiper does that.
In 1967, every major car company in the world was struggling to invent the intermittent windshield wiper. The solution...
Hey, Dad! Mom wants to know where the blender is!
It's down here! He's taking it apart!
...came from a college professor in Detroit.
Ford is very interested.
Why, Ford? Wow. They want it.
The guy name was Robert Kearns, and Robert Kearns created the intermittent wipers. So he created it, he patented it, he had everything that he's supposed to do, and then he showed it to Ford, and Ford looked at it and says, oh, we're interested, we want to get into business with you, this is great. They took the unit based on the idea that they wanted to do business with them. They already started, you know, talking about it, and then all of a sudden Ford says they're out, they don't want to do it anymore.
They want out, Bob.
Who wants out?
Ford.
Out? They have the unit.
I know.
Introducing the finest Ford Mustang and the brand new intermittent windshield wiper. Let's give it a hand.
That is my design.
Right this way, sir. Outside, please.
And again, he was 100% right. So he goes to court to fight it, and it was Goliath versus David. And again, any situations, Goliath tends to win.
Suing one of the most powerful corporations in the world, that's something you take on lightly.
Ford does not know the meaning of years or money. This is about more than money. This is about right and wrong, and you know it.
So after 26 years of him fighting it, you know, on his own, he went through every lawyer. He expended everything. He lost practically everything. He finally won, and Ford admitted that they stole it, and he actually won his day in court. You can be on the right side of the law, but if a major corporation comes after your work, it becomes very hard for you to fight. So what happens is they will tie you up your time with money. They will just drag you out until you just peter out or run out of money or just give up. And most people, 98% of people, just tend to give up because they can't fight it. That is a very real world scenario of what happens within corporations and things being stolen. The mindset of a corporation is they have no mindset. They are a monolith.
We are the Borg. Lower your shields and surrender your ships.
Corporation is to make money. To make money as much as possible, to lose money as little as possible, and there's no feelings involved. They won't say like, well, he's a nice guy, we'll take care of him. They will not do that. They will only do what they are forced to do. They only spend money when they have to. When a corporation does charity work, they're only doing charity work because it makes them look good to the public. And so that would be... the public, that will be your best chance of stopping a corporation from beating you up. When you put out your work, the best thing you can do is have the public know about it, have the public on your side, have the public see what you do, have a following. And if, say, a corporation comes along and try to steal your work and say, hey, they stole my work, and you turn to your million fans and say, my million fans, I love you guys, please help me, the corporation is stealing my work, then in fact, they can in fact help turn a tide against the corporation, and the corporation will say like, well, they caught us red-handed, they have all the paperwork, you want to go to court, because now it's a news story, there's a million fans mad at the corporation. So then the corporation at that point was like, okay, we'll give you a significant amount of money for your work, or we'll let it go, or something like that. If a bully comes and take your lollipop, they say, taking candy from a baby, are you strong enough to take the candy back? Or are you strong enough to do something about it? So if you're the baby, and your candy's taken from you, you better holler and scream like nobody's business to say, okay, I'll give it back. Exclusive number two, the public domain. Real world stuff. So, once something falls into the public domain, it's supposed to be in the public domain forever. Because it was copywritten, and then the copyright expires, and it goes into the public domain. That means, supposedly, that anyone should be able to use it in any way they see fit, in any fashion, way, form, whatever. It's the public domain. But, again, in the United States, copyright law is a moneymaker beyond moneymaker. The corporations make tons of money by having copyrights and trademarks, and the lawyers make tons of money fighting in court over copyrights and trademarks between companies, between individuals. So, because understanding that is the structure of how things exist, so you understand the jungle that you're getting into. The Sherlock Holmes story, Sherlock Holmes is also public domain. Anybody can use it, you can do whatever you want with it, Sherlock Holmes, Watson, so forth and so on. The Enola Holmes story.
Mycroft and Sherlock.
Yes, Sherlock Holmes.
The famous detective, my genius brother. He will have all the answers.
Enola.
Which is on Netflix. The Arthur Conan Doyle's estate sued Netflix. They said that there are 10 stories left that's not in the public domain. Like, that they only have a year or so left, but those still are actually copywritten. And they only have like a year or two to go. And I think it might have lapsed already at this point from what I heard. But there's only like a year or two left on the final Sherlock Holmes stories, where everything pertaining to Sherlock Holmes from the original Arthur Conan Doyle books will be totally public domain. But I think it's a few that's left. The estate of Arthur Conan Doyle sued Netflix, stating that Sherlock Holmes and Watson became warmer characters towards the end. In the early stages of the book, he was more aloof and more cold towards women. And his character changed to being more warm towards the end of the series than where he was in the beginning of the series. And so the estate of Arthur Conan Doyle sued Netflix, saying that you're portraying Sherlock Holmes as a warmer character when he was actually colder in the beginning. So those warm character traits that we think that you're displaying are the ones that are still under the copyright, and you should give us money. They actually sued for that. People will sue big corporations, and they will look at lawsuits sometimes and say, is this a legitimate lawsuit? Yes or no? Yes, it's legitimate, or no, it's not legitimate, but they have enough and within the lawsuit to give us a fight. And how long it's going to take us to fight this? It'll take us a year. How much is it going to cost for a year fighting in court? It's going to cost as much. You know what? Offer them this much money, tell them to go away. And they'll offer you a little bit of money and to go away. And a lot of times people take the money and they just go away. Netflix got geared up to the Lord and said, you know, we're not paying you. You cannot copyright the emotions of a character. And you can't, because what I said in the beginning, it's the expressed idea in a tangible form. After so many months, the estate of Arthur Conan Doyle dropped the lawsuit. I hope you got a lot out of this video for copyrighting and trademarking. But if you're finished and you're ready to make money with your comic book, I suggest you watch this video next.